I'm much happier on a piano keyboard than I am on a computer keyboard. But it's a story I had to tell. Hi, my name is Dennis King, and I've had an amazing life, both in music and show business, so much so that I've had to write it down. And I've called it Key Changes, a musical memoir. As the family story goes, apparently I sat down at the piano in the front room one day, aged five, and played precisely what my father had just played, Don't Fence Me In. So he decided to encourage my two elder brothers, Mike and Tony, neither of whom were musicians, into forming this trio. I was the pianist, Mike played guitar, and Tony played the double bass, and formed ourselves into an act and called ourselves the King Brothers and got a break on BBC television, which led to all manner of things. On the strength of that, we decided to turn professional. I was 13 at the time. We were Britain's first boy band. I mean, they weren't called that in those days, but we were. There was nobody else around.
Here I go again. I hear the trumpets blow again.
Life on the road in those days, the early 50s, was something called twice nightly variety. You see, it was a different world in those days. I mean, the fact that my parents, or our parents, let three young boys out into the, you know, dangerous world of touring, it didn't seem to bother any of us or any of them. I mean, Mike was my chaperone. He was only 17.
Chapter 9, The Singing Group That Sizzles.
Sweet sweet, the memories you gave.
When we weren't on the road doing summer seasons, variety tours, concerts or TV appearances, the King Brothers could usually be found at home in Essex rehearsing new material in our parents' front room.
We worked with a lot of major stars, both British and American and worldwide. And that was a real thrill when it happened, for me particularly. I mean, to actually share a stage with Frank Sinatra, admittedly on a charity show at the Royal Festival Hall in 1962, was to that date my biggest thrill, because he was my idol.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. And now here they are once again, the Swinging King Brothers.
They wing, they wing.
Otherwise, were fabulous.
Ladies and gentlemen, now the fabulous Morecambe Brothers. One, two, three.
Wait a minute.
We had worked with them in a previous life, being in variety, before they made it in a huge way. And then we subsequently did a TV series with them and had a great deal of fun. We were guests for, you know, every week. They had a musical act, and we did quite a few of those. So, and we occasionally did a little sketch with them, and it was hysterical. Particularly Eric was just, you know, was a comic genius anyway.
But you've ruined the whole thing!
Yes, how can we do a song like this? The whole thing's ridiculous.
Shut up! Understand?
But that was a great thrill, and then subsequently to work with, you know, Judy Garland, and I played piano a little bit for Tony Bennett in his hotel suite. And I did a duet with Nina Simone, which was something major. I mean, she was, again, one of my sort of idols, really, and had a fearsome reputation, but for some reason it was at a party. I was doodling on the piano when she arrived, and she sort of came straight over the piano, didn't push me out of the way, she's move on, she's a big lady. And she said, come on, let's play something together. And I ended up playing a sort of 12-bar blues with her, playing the top half and me playing the bottom half. And I kept looking at her, and she was great, and she kept looking at me. And at one stage she stopped and she said, looked at me, turned to me and said, hey man, you swing.
A white smart coat and a pink carnation.
a good life?
Yes. Slight pause. It was good in many ways. I mean, it wasn't a life that, because we were the King Brothers and we were quite famous for a time, that we earned a lot of money. We never did. We came in at the time before the boom in popular music, pop music, you know, obviously with the bands, all started to earn vast sums of money, but we never did. We just had enough money to buy our parents a house and a few quid on the side, but never made much money at all. But it was a good life because we were able to do things that we otherwise would never have done if I'd been at a factory or the others. It opened up the world, really. So, yes, it was a good life. I can't say that it was anything but.
Chapter 14, Horses for Courses.
I received a phone call from a music publisher to say that there was a television series about to be filmed about a horse. It's called Black Beauty, and the producers were looking to find the theme for the television series. Would I be prepared to submit an idea? And I said yes. The title Black Beauty sparked me off, really. I thought, Black Beauty. So the first three notes, Black Beauty. And why that came to me like that. Mm-hmm. And as a result of that, I thought, well, I'll go on from there. And then it should run up a bit. And then down again, because the horse is jumping over a field. And then become very pastoral, because it sort of feels... And then build up again to a key change. The same thing echoes the first part, etc., with a big climactic finish and bum bum. And I put it on tape, just on piano, sent it in to Harry Rubinowitz, the great Harry Rubinowitz of London Weekend, and he informed me that I was then in the finals, so to speak. They'd whittled it down to four, and then two, and then congratulations, they've chosen your theme. But you do know you'll have to orchestrate it for a 40-piece orchestra and choir within the next 6 days, because they've already got the studio booked. And me, who'd never done an orchestration for anything more than about a four-piece band, suddenly had to get involved in writing for a full orchestra, strings, horns, woodwinds, percussion, all the rest of it. And it was unbelievable. I knew I had to do it, even though I didn't have much of a clue as to how.
Composing the incidental or background music for The Adventures of Black Beauty proved something of an adventure itself. It was a considerably more complicated operation than scoring the theme. I'd never experienced synchronising music to film, never seen anyone do it, and didn't know how on earth it was done.
I was asked to write a piece of music for the series Lovejoy, with starring Ian McShane, about an antiques dealer in rural Suffolk or North Suffolk, and I thought, yes, I've got a tune for that. And I set it on a harpsichord, and it's gone on to be, you know, a very popular piece of music. But it's the old adage about never waste a good tune.
Chapter 19, Privates on Parade.
It was a huge success. It won 8 awards, Privates on Parade, including the Best British Musical, the Best Play, the Best Performance by Dennis Quilley, and Nigel Hawthorne won Best Supporting Actor. But it was a brilliant play. It was pretty daring for its time. It was considered to be extremely rude, wartime language. But I just loved the process. I loved working with the director and the choreographer and
orchestrating the show for this for the RSC, and it went on to win the Ivor Novello Award. Say, and it's been done and still being done all over the place, revived every couple of years or so. And on the strength of that, I was asked to do some more theatre, and subsequently I've done, I think, 25 shows with different writers over the years here and in the States. And it's part of, probably one part of writing music that I enjoy more than anything, is writing songs for characters, for situations. And it's gone on from there, really.
Of the private, on parade, on parade, parade.
People that read it, who probably have very little knowledge of that period that I started in, you know, the 50s, 60s, and the recording business and making records at Abbey Road before the Beatles. And people, I think, will pick up on the life I led and how I went about writing or performing or rehearsing or meeting. And be amused and entertained and, I don't know, educated. That's a rather pompous word to say. But learning about a life that, you know, that doesn't exist anymore. It's only when I stop and think that I realise what I've done, not necessarily what I've achieved to an extent, but what I've experienced, which is the thing. And I've met so many wonderful people and lovely people, and I think I've done pretty well, really.